Ah, Papa, we thank you for your presence in this place. You're so good. And I pray, Papa, that you would release your word to us this morning. And Lord, a lot of times we hear your word and we hear it over and over and over and over again. But I pray, Lord, today that by your Spirit you will impregnate us with that which you want us to run with, and that your word will live on the inside of us. That will be the word that you'll be watching over to perform. And I pray, God, that as we hear your word, we will respond, and that we'll be the legs, we'll be the positioning, Lord, for your word to be manifest. And so I just pray, God, that we'll be ready here today to receive that which your Spirit wants to impart, and we won't let it go. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. This is a word that I'd mentioned at, or I'd spoken at the Brazilian group that we go to on the Tuesday night, but I kind of like wanted to bring it to us. And I know it's quite a simple word, but it's for me, it kind of just clarifies things, and I want to try and make it simple this morning so that we're actually walking just in the simplicity of God's word. Okay, in Romans 4:11, it speaks about Abraham there, about Abraham by faith believed God, and so by believing God, it was credited to him as righteousness. Okay, so he believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. In verse 20 to 22, it says he didn't waver in his faith, or he didn't have any unbelief on the inside of him, but he stood firm, believing, fully persuaded that God was able to do what he had promised. Okay. Hallelujah. Now, how many of us are full of promises that God has given us? Okay, we want church where we sit and we get loads of promises from God. Okay, we've probably got diaries and diaries full of God's promises. Here, Abraham was fully persuaded that God was able to do or perform what he had promised. Okay, fully persuaded. And that was imputed as righteousness to Abraham. In verse 23 to 25, it says, and this will also be imputed to you. This will also be credited to you as you believe on him that raised Jesus from the dead for our sins and justification. Okay, so the same is true for you as was for Abraham. Okay, so it's credited to you as well. So what we get from this is that Abraham believed, and as Abraham believed, it aligned him with God. It aligned him with righteousness. It aligned him with right standing, isn't it? That's what righteousness means, is I have right standing before God. And so it aligned him to this position of right standing with God. And so what it was is it put him in line with the source. Okay. Of righteousness. Now in Jeremiah, remember Jeremiah 2 verse 13, it says, my people have committed two sins. They've forsaken me, the source of living water, and they've dug for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. Okay. Now those are the two sins that we constantly keep committing, is that we keep on relying on our own strength, we're relying on our own resources, our own abilities, our own clever plans and schemes and things like that of how we can get ourselves out of problems and situations and so forth, isn't it? That's what we do. You land yourself in a situation, immediately you're looking to, well, how can I get out of this? What can I maneuver? What can I come up with? What plan can I have? And then you come up with this plan, you say, ah, God bless this plan of mine. Okay, I really believe that was from God. I just received a plan from God right now. And we come up with all these little scenarios. But basically, it's saying, listen, I've got to align myself to the source. And he's got to be the source for everything. Okay, all I got to do is bring myself to this place where I say, I believe, I believe. I am fully persuaded that God is able to perform what he's promised. And it aligns me with the source of it all. Amen. Now, what's important is for us to recognize his faith did not make him righteous. Okay? His faith did not make him righteous. It aligned him with the righteousness. Okay? It aligned him to be credited with righteousness. That's all his faith did, but his faith didn't make him righteous. That's important, because if that's the case, then we are saved by our works and not by the grace of God. Okay? Very important. It's kind of like putting yourself in a position to that which is available to you. If you think about the oldest brother in the story of the prodigal son, and so dad comes and he slaughters the calf and blah blah blah, throw this big party for this renegade that's returned and just a real dropout, and so he's having this fat party for this guy, and this oldest son, he's just been so committed. We know the story, you know, and he's like, you know, you've never done this for me. Look at everything I've done for you. I'm constantly here. I'm faithful. I'm working hard. I'm doing everything that a son should do. And you've never done this for me. You know, you've never thrown a party for me. So the father responds and says, but don't you know everything I have is yours? And so that's for us to recognize sonship brings us to the place of everything is mine because you're a son. And that's what I got to recognize, that this qualifies me. I'm a son, I'm a daughter. It qualifies me that everything that belongs to the Father is mine. Amen? It's a simple truth, and we got to live in it. So believing aligns us with you, God. And so faith connects us with who he is. Faith connects us with him as our God, as our provider, as everything that I need. It makes me one with God. Okay. Now the NIV uses the word credited in the translation. The King James uses the word imputed. I like the word imputed. It's a nice word. It's a good word, imputed. Imputed. Say it with me. Imputed. Imputed. You sound posh. I've been imputed with righteousness. It's nice, isn't it? And basically what it means is it connects you to the source. Imputed means to be connected to the source. Okay, so now in our modern language, we use the word credited. Excuse me, sir, we've made a mistake and we have now credited 100 euros to your account. Yay! Kind of thing. It's been credited. You've just received that. Okay, so we understand that. Now, the Holy Spirit is imparted to us. Okay. That's what we got to understand. When you've received the Holy Spirit, that has been imparted to you. It's the breath of God. He lives in you. He's a free gift that the Lord has given to you. What he does is he will never leave you. He won't forsake you. He will always be there. He's your comforter. He leads you into all truth. He's what guarantees your sonship. Okay, important. He guarantees your sonship. You've received the deposit of the Holy Spirit. Okay, and so I feel like he broods over the chaos. He broods over people's lives. He broods over situations, because really nobody can say Jesus is Lord but by the Spirit of God. Amen. You were not filled by the Holy Spirit when you said Jesus is Lord. Amen. You were not filled with the Holy Spirit when you said Jesus is Lord. The Spirit of God came and opened your eyes, made you aware of who Jesus is, brought truth to you, and you were able to say Jesus is Lord. Okay. And so I feel like what happens is the Holy Spirit comes and he fills us with everything that we need in order for us to understand this relationship with God. Okay. And bang, he makes us alive to Christ. He makes us alive to our inheritance. He makes us alive to sonship. He makes us alive to every spiritual blessing that's in heavenly places. Amen. He makes us alive to our heavenly position, seated with Christ in heavenly places. And so what he does is he brings us into life eternal, where immortality is swallowed up by immortality. Amen. And you become a new creation. I kind of like thought about it, and I thought, he's like the Visa card. Okay. The Holy Spirit is like the Visa card that you have that allows you to draw from heaven. Okay. Does that make sense? So my account is charged with everything that is in Christ. Everything that is in Christ is my account. And through the Holy Spirit, I draw from that account. Hallelujah. I draw everything that I need from that account through the Holy Spirit. Okay? And it's all and all of that is accomplished through the Holy Spirit. And when I take that card, I believe. You know, when you take your credit card, okay, my situation is not the case. So it's not a very good example. When I go to that thing and I'm like, and it goes, bing, and nothing. When I hear the chick, I think, oh, praise God, something's going to come out. When I hear those little wheels turning inside, I think, oh, God, something's going to come out. But, that, okay, so my case is not a very good example. But one day, George and I went to America, and we had this ministry trip that we had gone on. How long did we go to Colorado for? And then 2 weeks, yeah. So we went away for 2 weeks, and we kind of like scrounged together what we had. And then somebody came up to us, a good friend, and said, I want you to take my credit card with you. Now, the friend said there's probably about 900,000 in that card. So, but you know what happened? We didn't necessarily have to use that card, but we were completely at peace. The whole trip, we were at peace just because we got this card. No matter what situation I'm in, whoa, that card has got power. Hey? And I was just, we were like just so confident and comfortable because we got this card. There's a lot of money in this card. And really, we had the most amazing trip. Why? Yeah, we were. But we had the most amazing trip because why? We were totally at rest, at peace. Just because of that. Just because we had this card. Not necessarily that we were like drawing anything from it. It was just we were at a place of confidence and peace. And that's where we have to be with the Holy Spirit. Okay? Totally confident that that which is in heaven, that which is in heavenly places, that which has been accredited to my account is real. It's true. It's there for me. And I do not have to worry that nothing's going to happen. I don't have to worry that there is nothing there. Amen? In Christ, it's been imputed to me. He is my source of whatever is needed. Then, by the Holy Spirit, I am led in what manner, in how and where and when to draw from that account. Amen? So I might be in a situation where there is somebody who's sick. I can inquire at that time, Holy Spirit, in what way, in what manner am I to draw from that account from heaven for you to be a source in this person's life right now? Amen. Still, I'm not presumptuous. I know Jesus wants to heal, but I want to be led in what manner by the Holy Spirit. Amen. And that sometimes when the Holy Spirit might say, well, this person's really struggling with a lot of forgiveness towards their parents. That's why their back is all distorted. Okay? And so instead of me just being presumptuous and saying, God, heal this back in the name of Jesus, and that's maybe what he wants me to do, and bam, it's finished. But he might say, why don't you just ask this person what their relationship is like with their parents? And so you say, can you tell me about your relationship with your parents? And so, and then you know where to go, and you know what the Holy Spirit is showing you, because he wants to release that person from a lot more than just his back. Okay, so that's when we just being led by the Holy Spirit, and to accomplish that which everything that Jesus accomplished on the cross is to be brought here on the earth. So really, you can only take what somebody else has accomplished or done or has. Okay. In the case of Jesus, that's what can only be imputed to you, is that which Jesus has accomplished. What has Jesus accomplished on the cross on your behalf? Everything. He's come to destroy all the works of the devil. Amen. He's come to completely destroy all the works of the devil. He took back the keys of Hades. Amen. To unlock every prisoner, to set free, to heal. Amen. So everything that he's done, that can be imputed to you. Right. But what can't be imputed to you is his character. He can't give you his character, but he gives you his Holy Spirit. He imparts to you his Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is what works out character in you. Amen. The Holy Spirit comes and he works on your character. He works on those things that are just not so nice in you, the things that are not love in your life. And that's where I've got to grow. I've got to grow in character. But everything regarding that which Jesus has done on the cross, that is 100% yours. It's imputed. Do you get that? Do you understand? But I'm going to grow in character. I'm going to grow in the things of the fruit of the Spirit. And evidence of the Spirit of God working in my life is me growing in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Amen. In measures that I grow in those things as I allow myself to be led more and more by the Holy Spirit, as I allow the Holy Spirit to do a work in my life. And that's what I believe the Holy Spirit is doing right now, is the Holy Spirit is just coming in a greater measure. And the reason I felt like God was giving me this word is because what Daryl brought on last Sunday was really prophetic. God wants to start releasing healing. God wants to start moving in the community. God wants to start seeing the kingdom of heaven invade this earth. Amen. And so when he brought that word about God releasing healing, I feel it is so timely for where we are right now. We have gone through such frustration of seeing people close to us just die within weeks. Okay, and that brought just this frustration. What it should do is bring a passion to say, no more. I want to start moving in the greater things and in the power of who Jesus Christ is. Amen. And see the work of the devil destroyed. It's about time. Amen. It's about time. And Georgia was saying the other day, she says, I'm so tired of having this glimpse of victory, this moment of glory, and then bam, at about 500 things that just come crashing down. No, it's got to turn. Amen. The tables have got to now start turning. And in order for the tables to start turning is for me to start understanding who I am and what has been imputed to me. Amen. Through Jesus Christ. In Colossians 2, verse 9 and 10, it says, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, speaking about Jesus Christ. All the fullness lives in Christ in bodily form. And then it goes on to say, have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. Whoa, hello, hello. This is truth. This is truth. This is what's been imputed to you as an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven, is that you walk in the full weight of the authority and power of Jesus Christ. Hello? It's got nothing to do with your character. Okay? It's got nothing to do with how worthy you are. It's got nothing to do with how you've screwed up or not screwed up. This is got to do with what's been imputed to you because you believe. The Spirit of God is working on your character, and praise God, he's working on my character. And that's, you know, even in Scripture says Jesus grew in favor with God and with man. And we've got to do the same. I mean, we've got to grow in favor with man. We've got to grow in favor with God. I know we have favor with God, but it's like, you know what happens is sometimes God says, okay, now I'm releasing you. There's the favor of God in your life. Now I'm calling you into this situation, right? I'm anointing you like David. I'm anointing you as king. Okay, when did he anoint David as king? When he was a young lad. When did he become king? Much later. Okay, so imagine this is what happens in the kingdom of heaven is, okay, I'm calling you, I'm anointing you as king. Whoa, now everybody, I'm king. I'm king. You just got to recognize that. I'm king here, okay? And so there's no character, there's just a lot of arrogance. That person has not grown in favor with man yet. Man has not recognized the call on this person yet. Amen. Because their character stinks. All right. So what happens is the Holy Spirit starts to work in our life, and he starts to develop character. He starts to develop us in a way that when God starts to move us, I can start becoming a person of character, a person who reflects Christ, a person who somebody is with and says, I like this guy and I want him to speak into my life. I value this person. I value, and so I want to go and share things with this person because I recognize something of character and of substance in this person's life. What, there's something about you. There's something different about you that I really like. There's a light that's coming from you. That's you growing in character, and the Spirit of God is working in your life, and you're becoming more and more Christ-like. Okay. And we've got to allow the Holy Spirit to do that because we represent the kingdom of heaven. Amen. We represent Christ. And so we have access to every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. We have access. Now, did Jesus raise the dead? Amen. Did Jesus heal every manner of sickness? Did Jesus cast out demons? Did Jesus open blind eyes? Did he unstop deaf ears? Did he cause the lame to walk? Did he open prison doors, set the captive free? Did he feed the hungry? Yes, he did. Did he clothe the poor? I don't really remember. But you see, this is what Jesus did and came to do. And this is what's been imputed to you. Right? Is that all I have to do is believe. Believe not in me, but believe in Jesus. Because if I start to believe in me, I'm going to doubt whenever I pray for somebody. But when I come and pray for somebody, first of all, I'm in Christ and I have the fullness of him who has the fullness of the deity in bodily form, right? That he is the head over every authority and every power. All right, so I come, that's imputed to me. I come in that authority when I pray for somebody, knowing that this is a work of the devil and it's going to be destroyed. Amen. Not in my authority. So let our faith start rising. Amen. When you pray for somebody, let our faith start rising and say, oh, no, I believe Jesus can do this. I believe that he is able to do this. Amen. And that's why we are priests. We are called to be a priesthood. Amen. The priesthood of all believers, right? We are all priests. And God has called us to be mediators of that which he's done on the cross. Mediators for the kingdom of heaven. Right? He's called you to stand between heaven and earth and mediate that which is in heaven here on earth. That's why you're a priest. Amen. And the problem, you know what happens is the other day, I just felt like the Lord was leading me to read from Judges 17 to 21 to the end. And it was the worst, darkest time in the history of Israel. I mean, horrid, terrible. You read that book, awful stuff. But every chapter starts with, and they had no king, and they had no king, and they had no king, and they had no king. And it ends with saying, and everyone did according to what he thought best. Okay. They were a law unto themselves. And so I read all the commentaries on it. They had no king. That's why they were in such a mess. They had no king because every chapter starts, they had no king. Israel was never meant to have a king. God was to be their king. Only God was meant to be their king. It had nothing to do with them having no king. It had to do with the priesthood. You read the story, the priests were terrible. It was the priesthood that caused Israel to be in such dire situation. Why? Because they had such self-motives. They were after their own interests. How was this going to benefit me in that situation? Listen, they inquired of the Lord and God gave them what they wanted. God gave them what they wanted as they inquired of the Lord. And the casualties just mounted up. They inquired of the Lord again. Casualties mounted up. Brother against brother and the slaughter of one another. But God gave it to them because they inquired of the Lord. But listen, their motives were wrong. Their hearts were in the wrong place. We are a priesthood in the kingdom of heaven. Amen. We need to start watching our motives. And we got to go deeper. We got to go deeper with the Lord. We've got to watch our hearts. Why am I in this? What am I doing this for? It's just so that you can stand as a mediator for the things of the kingdom of heaven. Not to take sides, not to judge, not to be vengeful or anything like that. Amen. This is an important time for us to say, God, I know that you've called me as a priest. And so this is a really bad situation here and a bad situation here, but I want to stand impartial between them. You've called us as priests to forgive sins. And so, you know, stand there impartial to each place and just let the kingdom of heaven come. Yeah? Just usher in the kingdom of heaven. Be that mediator. Amen. So I want to end there with just challenging us to become hungry. Hungry to see God start touching people's lives and taking opportunities now that as they come your way, say, Jesus, I know that you can heal this sickness. I know that you can deliver here. I'm tired of people that have been tormented in their mind with stuff and held bondage for all their life over stuff. It's easy to see, say, maybe a sickness healed, but people's minds, them being healed in their minds, being healed in their thinking. Let's believe God to see any manner of sickness destroyed. Amen. And healed. So let's believe. Align ourselves with heaven today. Align yourself with heaven today. We're going to take communion. And I want you to, in this time of communion, is to put faith into practice. You're partaking of Jesus. Amen. You're partaking of what he did on the cross for you. You're partaking of him destroying all manner of sickness, him setting completely free, him causing your cup of salvation to overflow. Whatever you are crying out for in your heart, whatever you have been longing for in your heart, partake of Jesus today. Let it just be imputed to you. Amen. Connect to the source. And so, take communion by faith today. Yeah? Let's do that. So,